than that of an 8-year-old child. But when we investigate the company that makes the Sam Phantom head, we discover that the news is even worse. The Sam Phantom isn't just the average of 10,000 people. It's the average of 10,000 US Army personnel. And US Army personnel most certainly have a larger, bigger, thicker head than the average 8-year-old. It's pretty reasonable to assume that if most mobile phones were tested against the skull of an 8-year-old, they would fail.
Who is it that sets the standards?
A group of people from a committee called ICNIRP.
The people who do the work on mobile phones are, by and large, engineers. They have no idea what is going on inside the living cell, but they are pontificating on this. They make the assumption that the only thing that can affect the well-being of a living organism is if it is powerful enough to heat the tissue. But that's like saying, we know if we boil an egg, it goes hard. What they don't know is that if they don't boil the egg, it turns into a chicken. And they haven't the slightest idea how that happens, but yet they pontificate as if they do.
In 2011, the World Health Organization changed the danger rating of mobile phones, reclassing it as possibly carcinogenic to humans, based on an increased risk of contracting a geloma, the type of brain tumour associated with using a mobile phone. What was the catalyst for this abrupt change in status? There have been countless studies conducted into the possible health effects of mobile phones, some showing an effect, some showing no effect. But the most conclusive came from Leonard Hardell. He has overseen the largest and most comprehensive piece of research ever conducted, combining his own work with that of others from around the world. From the early 1990s, they have investigated the phone habits of more than 2,000 people from around the world. People with tumours such as astrocytoma and acoustic neuroma, the brain tumours associated most with mobile phone use due to their proximity to the ear. Their findings are shocking. They concluded that mobile phone use does increase the risk of a brain tumour. And they also discovered why earlier research showed no effect.
I think there's more evidence that it's carcinogenic than just possibly carcinogenic. But I can understand it in a way, because most of the cancers which will arrive haven't arrived yet. I mean, people haven't been using cell phones for long enough for the true effect to become apparent.
As is the case with other carcinogens, it takes at least 10 years before you start to see an effect from the exposure. Because the mobile phone explosion didn't really take hold until the late 1990s, it's not surprising we are just starting to see the effects right now. So what are the telecoms industry doing to protect its users from contracting a brain tumour? A flick to the far reaches of their safety manuals suggests that they are more concerned about protecting themselves. At the back of almost every single phone's user guide are instructions on how far to keep your phone from your body. Instructions which, in the most part, are wholly unworkable. And what happens when the telecoms industry funds research into the harm that they are causing? And that research concludes that there is an effect. That the use of a mobile phone does play a role in the development of cancer. They tend to keep that research to themselves.
We just don't know what we're storing up with EMF because the effects are largely long-term. And we have, as you say, this ubiquitous exposure and ubiquitous reliance on these exposures. We just don't fully understand yet what we're doing.
Although the epidemiology clearly shows that using a mobile phone increases the risk of contracting a brain tumour, what people like ICNIRP need to see is a definitive cause and effect. How it happens? What's the mechanism? How exactly is the cancer caused? It may seem obvious that a being so tuned in to the Earth's frequencies and so sensitive to her magnetic fields would naturally have a reaction to man-made microwaves. But for years, the telecoms industry have defended their actions by asking the same question. As it turns out, they've been asking the wrong question. The answer is melatonin.
You know, melatonin is a hormone, and believe it or not, it's made in the brain. It's made in the pineal gland of the brain, and it's got a very powerful antioxidant status compared with vitamins. For example, melatonin is 5 times as powerful as vitamin C and twice as powerful as vitamin E. And it secretes only at night, and it's at night that we need it because that's when we go to sleep and when our brain repairs the cells of our body. And that's when melatonin comes out to do its work.
Each day, our body loses about 500 million cells. And at night, that's when our body replaces those cells through a process called cell mitosis, the dividing of cells.
And what it's doing is it's mopping up what are called free radicals. These free radicals are really the spare electrons left over from the process of making the energy which we need to repair our cells in the first place.
Each night, as our body repairs itself, millions of free radical cells are created as a byproduct of cell mitosis. These free radical cells attack healthy cells. It is universally agreed that the free radical cell is the main causal factor in most cancer. Our body's main defense against these free radicals is its most powerful antioxidant, melatonin.
It passes into the bloodstream, and its job is to act as a natural antioxidant, a natural anti-cancer agent. Melatonin is a very, very powerful anti-cancer agent.
What it does is it acts as a what's called an oncostatic agent, that is, it protects you against cancer. It controls the sleep-wake cycle. so that you get a good night's sleep when you've got proper melatonin. It's an anti-aging molecule. In other words, by mopping up those free radicals, it leaves your skin and complexion looking younger. We have in our lab 12,000 studies, which we've collected over the years. And that is more studies than have ever been published on paracetamol, which is the most common headache reliever. There's more scientific interest in melatonin than there is in paracetamol.
What are the consequences of having a reduced amount of melatonin?
Yeah. Well, you have a reduced amount of melatonin, and what happens then is that your immune system starts to be less competent, for a start. You tend to get sleep disturbance, you can't get off to sleep, or if you do, you wake up and can't get back to sleep. You can have heart complications because melatonin protects your heart as well. And you're much more prone to disease because your immune system is not functioning at its best. So these are some of the things that happen when you have a lowered melatonin level. And for example, the average woman with breast cancer has only got 1/10 of the melatonin of a normal woman of her age. And for people with prostate cancer, they've got less than half the melatonin that they should have. Autistic children have less than half the melatonin levels that they should enjoy.
Reduced melatonin in night shift workers, because they're working at night and exposed to light, they don't produce nocturnal melatonin, is known to produce a 50% increase in breast cancer risk. And the International Agency for Research on Cancer, IARC, has actually classed night shift work as a class 2A probable carcinogen because of this melatonin reduction.
There are lots of studies now showing that people on night shifts or people who are blind have different cancer rates than the average population. And most of those studies support the view that the absence or the lowered melatonin has an adverse effect on health.
Because the body only repairs itself at night, melatonin is only produced when the pineal gland senses that no light is present.
What happens is that the pineal gland is light sensitive. It's sitting right where your brain receives signals from your eyes at crossover point in the middle. It's called the suprachiasmatic nuclei. And the connections from there goes directly to the pineal gland to tell it whether there's any light around or not. If there's light around, then there's also interference with the signals the brain wants to send to our cells in order to repair them. So it says there's no point in the brain sending these signals out to our cells to tell them to repair, because there's so much interference that they won't hear it. So it waits, the brain waits until it's dark.
What kind of research has shown that there's an effect on melatonin production from electric fields, magnetic fields, radio waves?
Right, well, the Battelle Institute in America has done a lot of work on this way back from the late 1970s, in fact. And their scientists there, Barry Wilson and Dick Stevens and people like that, started thinking that because we know that if you turn the light on, then the brain stops making melatonin, they thought, well, maybe our brains can't distinguish between electric fields and that we make ourselves artificially, and the natural light that we all know happens during the daytime, because we just don't make melatonin in the daytime. For very good biological reasons. So they thought, well, maybe these electric fields